Penguin Random House Audio presents The Way Home, two novellas from the world of the last unicorn by Peter S. Beagle, read for you by Orlagh Cassidy. Two Hearts. My brother Wilfred keeps saying it's not fair that it should all have happened to me. Me being a girl and a baby and too stupid to lace up my own sandals properly. But I think it's fair. I think everything happened exactly the way it should have done, except for the sad parts, and maybe those too. I'm Sooz, and I am 9 years old. 10 next month, on the anniversary of the day the griffin came. Wilfred says it was because of me that the griffin heard that the ugliest baby in the world had just been born, and it was going to eat me, but I was too ugly, even for a griffin. So it nested in the Midwood. We call it that. But its real name is the Midnight Wood, because of the darkness under the trees, and stayed to eat our sheep and our goats. Griffins do that if they like a place. But it didn't ever eat children, not until this year. I only saw it once. I mean, once before, rising up above the trees one night like a second moon. Only there wasn't a moon then. There was nothing in the whole world but the griffin. Golden feathers all blazing on its lion's body and eagle's wings, with its great front claws like teeth and that monstrous beak that looked so huge for its head. Wilfred says I screamed for 3 days, but he's lying, and I didn't hide in the root cellar like he says either. I slept in the barn those 2 nights with our dog, Malka, because I knew Malka wouldn't let anything get me. I mean, my parents wouldn't have either. Not if they could have stopped it. It's just that Malka is the biggest, fiercest dog in the whole village, and she's not afraid of anything. And after the griffin took Jahane, the blacksmith's little girl, you couldn't help seeing how frightened my father was, running back and forth with the other men trying to organize some sort of patrol so people could always tell when the griffin was coming. I know he was frightened for me and my mother, and doing everything he could to protect us, but it didn't make me feel any safer, and Malka did. But nobody knew what to do anyway. Not my father, nobody. It was bad enough when the griffin was only taking the sheep, because almost everyone here sells wool or cheese or sheepskin things to make a living. But once it took Jahane early last spring, that changed everything. We sent messengers to the king, 3 of them, and each time the king sent someone back to us with them. The first time, it was one night, all by himself. His name was Duros, and he gave me an apple. He rode away into the Midwood singing to look for the griffin, and we never saw him again. The second time, after the griffin took Luli, the boy who worked for the miller, the king sent 5 knights together. One of them did come back, but he died before he could tell anyone what happened. The third time, an entire squadron came. That's what my father said anyway. I don't know how many soldiers there are in a squadron, but it was a lot. And they were all over the village for 2 days, pitching their tents everywhere, stabling their horses in every barn, and boasting in the tavern how they'd soon take care of that griffin for us poor peasants. They had musicians playing when they marched into the Midwood. I remember that. And I remember when the music stopped and the sounds we heard afterward. After that, the village didn't send to the king anymore. We didn't want more of his men to die. And besides, they weren't any help. So from then on, all the children were hurried indoors when the sun went down and the griffin woke from its day's rest to hunt again. We couldn't play together or run errands or watch the flocks for our parents or even sleep near open windows for fear of the griffin. There was nothing for me to do but read books I already knew by heart and complain to my mother and father, who were too tired from watching after Wilfred and me to bother with us. They were guarding the other children too, turn and turn about with the other families, and our sheep and our goats. So they were always tired as well as frightened, and we were all angry with each other most of the time. It was the same for everybody. And then the griffin took Felicitas. Felicitas couldn't talk, but she was my best friend, always, since we were little. I always understood what she wanted to say, and she understood me better than anyone, and we played in a special way that I won't ever play with anyone else. Her family thought she was a waste of food because no boy would marry a dumb girl, so they let her eat with us most of the time. Wilfred used to make fun of the whispery quack that was the one sound she could make, but I hit him with a rock, and after that he didn't do it anymore. I didn't see it happen, but I still see it in my head. She knew not to go out, but she was always just so happy coming to us in the evening, and nobody at her house would have noticed her being gone. None of them ever noticed Felicitas. The day I learned Felicitas was gone, that was the day I set off to see the king myself. Well, the same night, actually, because there wasn't any chance of getting away from my house or the village in daylight. I don't know what I'd have done, really, except that my Uncle Ambrose was carting a load of sheepskins to market in Hagsgate, and you have to start long before sunup to be there by the time the market opens. Uncle Ambrose is my best uncle, but I knew I couldn't ask him to take me to the king. He'd have gone straight to my mother instead and told her to give me sulfur and molasses and put me to bed with a mustard plaster. He gives his horse sulfur and molasses, even. So I went to bed early that night, and I waited until everyone was asleep. I wanted to leave a note on my pillow, but I kept writing things and then tearing the notes up and throwing them in the fireplace, and I was afraid of somebody waking or Uncle Ambrose leaving without me. Finally, I just wrote, "I will come home soon." I didn't take any clothes with me or anything else except a bit of cheese, because I thought the king must live somewhere near Hagsgate, which is the only big town I've ever seen. My mother and father were snoring in their room, but Wilfred had fallen asleep right in front of the hearth, and they always leave him there when he does. If you rouse him to go to his own bed, he comes up fighting and crying. I don't know why. I stood and looked down at him for the longest time. Wilfred doesn't look nearly so mean when he's sleeping. My mother had banked the coals to make sure there'd be a fire for tomorrow's bread, and my father's moleskin trews were hanging there to dry because he'd had to wade into the stock pond that afternoon to rescue a lamb. I moved them a little bit so they wouldn't burn. I wound the clock. Wilfred's supposed to do that every night, but he always forgets. And I thought how they'd all be hearing it ticking in the morning while they were looking everywhere for me, too frightened to eat any breakfast, and I turned to go back to my room. But then I turned around again, and I climbed out of the kitchen window because our front door squeaked so. I was afraid that Malka might wake in the barn and right away know I was up to something, because I can't ever fool Malka, only she didn't. And then I held my breath almost the whole way as I ran to Uncle Ambrose's house and scrambled right into his cart with the sheepskins. It was a cold night, but under that pile of sheepskins, it was hot and nasty smelling, and there wasn't anything to do but lie still and wait for Uncle Ambrose. So I mostly thought about Felicitas, to keep from feeling so bad about leaving home and everyone. That was bad enough. I never really lost anybody close before, not forever. But anyway, it was different. I don't know when Uncle Ambrose finally came, because I dozed off in the cart, and didn't wake until there was this jolt and a rattle and the sort of floppy grumble a horse makes when he's been waked up and doesn't like it, and we were off for Hagsgate. The moon was setting early, but I could see the village bumping by. Not looking silvery in the light, but small and dull, no color to anything. And all the same, I almost began to cry, because it already seemed so far away, though we hadn't even passed the stock pond yet, and I felt as though I'd never see it again. I would have climbed back out of the cart right then, if I hadn't known better, because the griffin was still up and hunting. I couldn't see it, of course, under the sheepskins, and I had my eyes shut anyway, but its wings made a sound like a lot of knives being sharpened all together. And sometimes it gave a cry that was dreadful because it was so soft and gentle, and even a little sad and scared, as though it were imitating the sound Felicitas might have made when it took her. I burrowed deep down as I could and tried to sleep again, but I couldn't. Which was just as well, because I didn't want to ride all the way into Hagsgate, where Uncle Ambrose was bound to find me when he unloaded his sheepskins in the marketplace. So when I didn't hear the griffin anymore, they won't hunt far from their nests if they don't have to. I put my head out over the tailboard of the cart and watched the stars going out one by one as the sky grew lighter. The dawn breeze came up as the moon went down. When the cart stopped jouncing and shaking so much, I knew we must have turned onto the King's Highway.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.